Can I welcome you all to this event, and can I particularly welcome Lord Weidenfeld and Lady Weidenfeld and Lord and Lady Foster, who are at the back here, and also to our visitors from outside of the university. As part of the time that Lord Foster gives to us at Oxford University is to organise a symposium. And what we try to do is to pick up some of the themes from the lecture that he gave us, the stimulating lecture he gave to us last night. And it's also an opportunity for Lord Foster and his team to meet some of the researchers in Oxford, the university here and at Brookes, and to exchange ideas. Now, the theme we picked upon today is the future of airport capacity, which is really focusing on the UK and the important role that London plays as a gateway airport. As we know, there's been considerable debate over many years about additional capacity at Heathrow Airport. And this has covered debates on runway capacity. It's looked at the links to the proposed HS2, the high-speed 2 rail link, accessibility more generally to airports, and the links between the main airports within the London region. And these are all important aspects of the transport system. But these transport issues need really to be placed in a much wider context of the role of airports in generating employment, their importance to national and regional economies, and their considerable environmental costs, including here the contribution to greenhouse gas emissions, other ground level emissions, and other forms of climate forcing. Now, last night we heard about the possibility of a new London airport in the Thames estuary on the Hoo Peninsula in the Isle of Grain. We suggested this airport could replace London Heathrow Airport and provide for the expected growth in air travel over the next sort of 50 years. And consideration had also been given in last night's lecture to the environmental issues of habitat, wildlife, to the issues relating to safety. As with the new airport, no planes would actually fly over the heavily populated area of the centre of London. And also it covered the hubway, the gateway function that such a huge investment would offer. So the important links to the existing transport system and the high-speed networks was also discussed. And many of the travellers, more than half, would actually come to the new airport by rail. So I think that the theme and the proposed links with Lord Foster's call for holism and more visionary thinking is really central to creating a transport infrastructure that is sustainable and works efficiently. And it's likely to meet the demands of an advanced society in the 21st century. But at the same time, looking at some of these broader environmental and social issues. So what we want to do today is to take that debate a little bit further. And the way we've decided to do this is to invite three speakers to represent some of the different but important aspects of airport planning and capacity. Firstly, we will have the view from Chris Moores, who is the principal transport planner within Transport for London. And he's been very closely involved in looking at London's strategic transport needs, which includes the need for the new hub airport in London. Then we will have Louise Condon, who is managing partner at York Aviation. She has a really extensive experience of the aviation industry, and she works really closely with the airports and the aviation industry, and has carried out a series of important studies on the economic impacts of airports. And then thirdly, we have John Brotherick, who is a key member of the Tyndall Manchester team, and he's been working with others on issues relating to carbon trading, emissions, and aviation. And the format we've adopted is that each of our speakers will have a maximum of 15 minutes to outline their perspective on the future of aviation capacity. We will then have a response from Lord Foster, and he will try and sort of add to these presentations, and we will hear about his take on those. And after that, he unfortunately has to leave shortly after that, we will have a questions and answers session. And here we would like to hear from as many as possible of you in terms of your input to this debate. This will be run as both a questions and answers, but primarily as a panel discussion with our three speakers. And then finally, at about 5:10, I'll give the floor to Hugh Thomas from Foster's and Partners. And I will give him, which is a a pleasant surprise to me, but I'll give him the difficult task of summing up and responding to some of the issues that have been raised, and perhaps sketch out some of Foster's and Partners' views on the next steps forward. So without any more, I will hand over to our first speaker, Chris Moores.
Hello, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, why is the Mayor of London interested in looking at a new airport, looking at a new airport perhaps outside of London? It is often a criticism levelled at him. Well, the Mayor is responsible for London's continued success. His vision is that London continues to excel amongst global cities and successfully expands its opportunities for its people and its enterprises. While the Mayor is not responsible directly for national aviation policy, he is accountable for London's transport system, and he has a strong interest in ensuring that this system develops in the best interests of London and the UK. So let's examine why aviation, and in particular the hub airport, is important to London and the UK. I'm going to run quickly through benefits of aviation, London's current provision, who uses London's airports and why, the economic importance of different sectors of aviation use, the importance particularly of a hub airport to this, the limitations of Heathrow, demand, how the world is changing, and the implications of current government policy. Aviation is a good thing for a great many people. We are an island nation, of course, and 4 out of 5 trips to the UK are made by air. 47% of the population flew at least once last year, well, in 2009, and £100 billion worth of goods were exported or imported by air. London's airports directly account for 107,000 jobs and a further 70,000 in their supply chains. And in terms of receipts to the UK Exchequer, in 2008 this was put at £8 billion a year. If we look at the UK airports at the moment and we look at where people are flying to from them, we can see that across Gatwick, Heathrow, Stansted, Manchester, Luton, all the principal airports, there's domestic and European travel relatively consistent. But it's the rest of the world travel that Heathrow comes into its own, with more than half of the passengers using Heathrow travelling to or from destinations in the rest of the world. And in terms of the journey purpose, if we look at Luton, Stansted and Gatwick, approximately 75% of passengers are flying for leisure purposes. Again, at Heathrow comes into its own, 1/4 of all passengers are flying for business, and 1/3 are interlining, transferring between flights. The Mayor recently published, last week, a document examining the economic benefits of a hub airport. And what that document tries to do is examine the different subsectors, the reasons why people fly. There's business, perhaps the most economically beneficial form of air travel. London has a highly productive international economy, financial and business services key to this, highly aviation reliant. Foreign direct investment accounts for 27% of London's economic output, and foreign firms account for 42% of wealth in London. Now, London's attractiveness as a business location depends on the availability of direct flights to a range of destinations across the globe at excellent frequencies. Inbound leisure generates valuable export revenues. London receives 1/2 of the UK's 30 million annual overseas visitors and 10 billion of the 16 billion that is spent in the UK every year. Outbound leisure. Well, it's an important source of allowing the UK's population to travel overseas, an enabler. But in terms of economic growth, the consumption benefits that outbound leisure generates are largely counteracted by the fact that it constitutes an import. Although visiting family and friends is very important, approximately 1/3 of London's population are born overseas, and many others have family roots outside of the UK. Cargo. 2/3 of air freight is carried in the belly hold of passenger aircraft, and air freight enables access to markets and more efficient production processes. And what we must remember is that all of those sectors which are most beneficial to the economy have a significant long-haul dimension. And it's at a hub airport, really, that they are brought together most effectively. While point-to-point airports serving London and the regions provide a valuable service, particularly in meeting outbound leisure demand, it's at a hub airport where business, where inbound leisure, where cargo can be brought together, relying on a comprehensive network of long-haul flights. And an efficient hub can consolidate demand across the subsectors. If you want to fly to Cebu City in the Philippines or Santiago in Chile, you have to fill up a plane full of 250, 400 people. And it's very difficult to do at locations outside of London. What we find at Heathrow is that 39 of Heathrow's routes have more than 50% of passengers who are transferring. Now, why hub airport? Why aviation? Can rail offer its connectivity around the world? Well, not really. Rail can only compete on routes of up to 3.5 hours in length. This constitutes approximately 10% of journeys at Heathrow. And we must remember that capacity is constrained through the Channel Tunnel. So the majority of aviation trips are not really viable by other modes. But we must remember that high-speed rail can complement a hub airport in the UK by expanding its connectivity, improving its catchment, improving the ability of the regions to tap into London's connectivity and the connectivity offered at an airport, a hub airport serving London. Regional airports. Well, the Department for Transport's recent demand forecasting exercise projects that by 2030, with no growth on additional capacity, London's airports will be full. And by 2050, this means 42 million people travelling to the regions, to airports outside of London and the South East to travel, and 50 million people not travelling at all. This means that millions of people will have to travel further by road and rail to fly, and the overall connectivity of the UK would likely deteriorate. So the regional airports find it very difficult to replicate the benefits of a London hub. And as mentioned, with an efficient high-speed rail network, a hub in the southeast could serve as a truly national hub. Now, what do we mean by an efficient hub airport? Well, sufficient takeoff and landing slot capacity. This diagram here shows the banked arrivals and departures at Schiphol Airport that allow people to come in from Paris, Milan, Glasgow, change planes and fly out to Shanghai, Washington, Cape Town. This is done 3 or 4 times across the day, and it allows an effective airport to really serve its catchment well and have a range of flights on offer that its local people can tap into. It needs sustainable and high-quality surface access, of course. Heathrow underperforms in this regard. It's very close to central London, but only 40% of its passengers use public transport to travel there. Anyone who's flown through Singapore Changi will know that a world-class passenger experience is also very important and appealing when making long-haul journeys. And of course, we've got to be aware of the harmful local impacts. So, how does Heathrow pitch at the moment against European hubs? Well, if we look at runways, 2 runways compared to Amsterdam's 6, Paris, Frankfurt and Madrid's 4. This limits the number of flights per hour, and this will become even more pronounced in the future as our rivals develop and are able to get better use out of their selection of runways. As a result, runway utilisation at Heathrow at the moment, very high, very little spare capacity, very little relief in times of delays and disruption. And what we find, what we have found, is that the destinations Heathrow served is falling. The number of destinations served by Heathrow's rivals is rising. This plot shows the last 10 years, the increase in service to some destinations around the world, but that it has come at the expense of other destinations, domestic connections, those in the Caribbean, those in Western Europe, are lost as Heathrow adapts and tries to provide new services. It's essentially a one-in, one-out policy. Heathrow performs well on its core routes, connections to North America, to India. It is strong, but it is becoming increasingly focused on these core markets. And it's being less successful at developing routes to new and emerging economies, If we look at China and the seats available to China from London's rivals, at Paris, 15,000, Frankfurt, 17,000 seats a week, nearly twice as many as London. Chinese airlines would like to come to London. They would like to come to Heathrow. China Southern, China's biggest airline, does not serve Heathrow. It does not serve the UK because it can't get a slot at Heathrow. As a result, they're taking their business, their passengers, elsewhere in Europe. This situation is only going to get worse. Demand pressures will increase. GDP and aviation use very closely linked. As we go forward, the world's GDP is forecast to become more dispersed. Asian, Latin American countries are expanding. 5 to 8% year-on-year growth. We'll be lucky if we have two. While we're in a recession here, it's not the same around the world. As we can see, if we were to look at the 25 biggest cities in the world in terms of total GDP, in 2007, a real concentration in Europe and North America. In 2025, Chinese cities, Guangzhou, Shenzhen, Beijing, Shanghai, they are emerging, they're coming on the world stage, and London wants to have connections to them. Is accommodating this demand environmentally acceptable? Can it be sustainable? Well, in 2009, the Independent Committee on Climate Change reported that 60% growth on 2005 levels is likely to be compatible with our environmental commitments to 2050. This constitutes approximately 160 million passengers per annum. That is an airport, if it's a single airport, almost twice the size of Heathrow. But the key point would be how we use any permissible growth. Would we want to focus it on those economic sectors, those sectors of demand that are most economically beneficial? Business, inbound leisure, and cargo. We must also remember that aviation is due to enter Europe's emissions trading scheme in 2012. Now, this could pitch aviation and its benefits against the benefits of other subsectors of the economy. And it might be a highly regulated market, but it could ensure that environmental improvements are made across the board and in sectors such as household energy consumption, where they might be easier to make, would put it to the market. So substantial aviation growth is both desirable economically and it's compatible with environmental commitments. Local impacts, however. Well, tremendous benefits generated by aviation, but they can really have a detrimental impact on their local environment. And nowhere is this more clear-cut, more obvious, more noticeable than at Heathrow, a densely populated area and flight paths over London. It's wholly unsuitable for further expansion. But we must remember that capacity can be sited so as to minimise noise and air quality impacts. If we look at Heathrow in comparison to other European hubs, it's got approximately 4 times the number of people affected by noise to 55 decibels. That's the point at which noise disturbance is significant. 4 times as many as Frankfurt, 6 times Charles de Gaulle, and up to 10 times Madrid and Amsterdam. So, we must do something. There's a very strong case for providing new capacity, new routes, new frequencies. If Heathrow is left to decline, this will harm our economy. It will benefit our competitors. Operational inefficiencies and delays and resilience. Heathrow is not operating as an efficient, effective hub at the moment. And to those that think that operational changes such as mixed mode could work, at the beginning of last week we had fog, we had substantial delays, and that just proves that tinkering around the edges will not solve the problem. We have to address the environmental problems that Heathrow's restricted capacity creates. The stacking, 30 to 40 minutes you can spend circling London, pumping out emissions. 20 minutes queuing for takeoff slots. Routine. So a new hub can directly benefit the regions and in the right location can address the environmental issues that aviation generates. What are the government doing about it? Well, in 2010, they withdrew their support for Heathrow's third runway and stated that they would not support any expansion at Stansted or Gatwick. They set up the South East Airports Task Force, but this was not capacity focused. They have embarked upon a new aviation strategy setting exercise, which is due to report in March next year. But will we see words, or will we see numbers and locations? What is the mayor doing? Well, he will continue to build the case. He has an ongoing work programme to look at the evidence, the reasons why a new London hub could work and in what circumstances it could be delivered. His next work will focus on commercial and environmental aspects. And the mayor is not wedded at the moment to any particular location or solution. But he is very keen that a full range of ideas are fully examined. And this includes, of course, the excellent vision put forward by Lord Foster. Thank you very much. I would just want to observe that the front page of the Times today was very positive. Search for growth lifts Estuary Airport hopes. And maybe the messages, the vision, the documents put forward to government are beginning to have an effect. Thank you.
Good afternoon. We spent quite a bit of the summer working with Chris Moores and the team at TfL, so I had to sort of try and guess today what he was going to talk about so I didn't duplicate. And although I was sort of billed as an airport economic impact expert, which we do a lot of work in, I'm not actually going to talk about that. What I am going to do is, if I can make this thing work, yes, is look at what I think are some of the issues and challenges about a potential new Thames Gateway Airport that maybe haven't yet been fully worked and thought through. I'm not saying they're insurmountable problems, but I think there are points and issues that need to be looked at in more detail in order to convince the aviation industry that this is a viable and workable solution. So I think that's the mismatch at the moment between what's on the table and understanding how the airlines and their passengers might actually respond. So I think there are three principal challenges. One is around the nature and location of demand in the London area. The second is around how airlines are going to respond to that demand. And the third is around affordability of a new major airport development. So when we look at options for airport developments, and I've been working in the sector now for well over 30 years and do think I know a little bit about it, you start first from looking at what the nature and location of demand is. And each of the London's airports, and I'm going to very, very quickly show you on some maps, has its own demand base and its own characteristics. There's more geographical distinction than you might expect. And I think this determines to quite a large extent the nature and role of each of the airports. So the first two key questions that I think need to be addressed under the sort of my first subheading is, to what extent would a new hub airport alter the nature of demand? And really, how quickly would other urban infrastructure be developed in the Thames Gateway, which would itself contribute to altering that geographic distribution? So just very quickly taking you through, if you like, the evidence base that lies behind those two questions. If we look here, just very quickly about some inbound-outbound distribution of demand. Foreign business demand, very heavily concentrated in central London, Westminster. And then a fairly even spread throughout the rest of Greater London and the surrounding southeast. You look at foreign leisure, very similar pattern. They spread themselves a little bit more into Camden and Kensington and Chelsea, but still a very similar pattern. If we look at UK business, and I think this is where it perhaps gets particularly interesting, yes, there's an awful lot of UK business demand that originates in Westminster. There's an awful lot of it that comes from Surrey. Now, you can say it comes from Surrey because all those businessmen have chosen to live in Surrey because it's near Heathrow. But I think that goes back to my question about how quickly would a new airport change those people's residential location decisions. But that, if you like, is one of my challenges, is if you close Heathrow and you move to a new hub airport, does that demand automatically follow? And I'll come back to that in a minute. UK leisure by county, and this is a bit distorted by the size of counties and the size of London districts, I appreciate, but it's, again, fairly evenly spread. Again, there's quite a big concentration in Surrey, but people in Essex travel quite a lot as well, so it's a bit more geographically spread. If we look at the shares, and I think with the lights on this isn't great, but basically red and paler colours are high shares, dark blue is low shares. business demand, again, is very concentrated in terms of share of overall demand in the M4 corridor, UK Silicon Valley. And in the east, business travel makes up a relatively low proportion of all air trips that are taken. If we look at the foreign share of demand, unsurprisingly, in the light of those other slides I showed you, very concentrated in central London, but quite a slug of foreign demand in Hounslow, although that is influenced by Heathrow. That's people spending the night near the airport before they go and fly. But the foreign demand doesn't penetrate very far, other than Windsor and Maidenhead and surrounding areas, outside of the central part of London. If we look at the airport catchment areas, London City is very important in its own catchment. It's basically the airport for Canary Wharf, the City of London and parts of Westminster. And it does spread its tentacles out eastwards, but it has very little penetration west of Kensington and Chelsea. Stansted, Essex. Stansted does quite well for foreign inbound trips to central London. It's all the people flying Ryanair on cheap tickets, coming in on backpacking weekends to London. But apart from that, its catchment area is very much Essex and neighbouring counties. Luton does much better in the north and the northwest of London. Lesser penetration into central London, perhaps a little bit surprisingly, given Ryanair and EasyJet are major users of that airport as well. Gatwick, south London. But it also has a very big penetration into Surrey. And it does reasonably well in Westminster because of the Gatwick Express link into Victoria for inbound trips. So when you then look at Heathrow, Heathrow's market penetration again is stronger in the west and again in central London and Westminster. I'm just going to very quickly go through some market share graphs. London City's market share is, again, very high in the core area in Docklands that it serves. This is market share of overall air travel trips made from those areas. Stansted's share, again, high in the east, low in the west. Luton share, very similar pattern, high in the north, low everywhere else. Gatwick share, which is the purple colour, high in the south, but low even in central London. Low penetration, low market share. And Heathrow's market share, very high on the M4 corridor. And I think those are the challenges really about if you close Heathrow and you move the airport, how do you address the fact that there isn't a homogenous block of demand at Heathrow? You've got a lot of people here who are going to have to travel a long way now to access an airport when they don't have to travel very far at all now. And it will give rise to, in itself, an economic cost and a productivity loss unless we can tackle the surface access dilemma. And regrettably, for the outbound business trips, we know from work we've done talking to City of London businesses for the City of London Corporation that those business travellers will not use the train. So we have to tackle the car-borne access as well as the rail-borne access. Airlines, who are important, because at the end of the day, passenger demand is one thing, but it's how airlines react to that demand which determines the fate of all of our airports. There are lots of examples over the decades where people have built new airports on the basis it would be great, wouldn't it? And the airlines haven't taken up that capacity, haven't responded. And what you have to look at when you're trying to understand why that is what's the nature of demand and what would incentivise an airline to respond to that demand or not. Business passengers are extremely important. They're extremely important to the economy, whether they're inbound business passengers, outbound business passengers, as Chris has said. But to make it work for an airline, they have to have a mix. They have to have a balance. They have to have a lot of full fare passengers, but equally they have to have the ability to fill up the seats at the back of the aeroplane with lower fare traffic, because it's a combination of yield and volume that makes money for the airline. It's not one or the other, it's both. The track record of business-only services worldwide is not great. It's not good. Transfer traffic is important to underpinning the viability of new routes, and I'll show you a few examples in a minute. But you have to remember that most passengers transferring on flights are low value. They're being sold cheap, because what the airlines do is British Airways are competing with Air France and KLM. So they sell seats to New York in Paris for far less than they sell them in London. and they're dragging low-fare traffic through Heathrow to underpin their viability in competition with Air France. And KLM France do exactly the same thing in the UK to drag traffic through there. So it's all about how the airlines compete determines this market mix. High value point-to-point demand, though, at the end of the day, is what will determine whether an airline will look at a route or not. It will then say, OK, I want to serve this high volume point-to-point demand, but maybe I have to attract some transfer traffic for a while to fill up the back of the plane in order to get to the point where I've got a viable service just meeting point-to-point demand. I think key to this is, my perception is, that the airlines will still seek to serve that West London market somehow. And so the traffic won't all transfer to the new hub. Airlines will seek to find different ways of serving that market. For example, a passenger living in Guildford who wants to go to Shanghai will have a choice of using the new hub airport that may take them some time to get to, or making a fairly slick connection through Dubai on Emirates, who do fly to Gatwick and will continue to fly to Gatwick. And Gatwick's route network will also change over time. So I think there's some real challenges there about how do you actually move demand. Even if Oneworld and British Airways move to the new hub, it's not automatic that the other carriers will follow them. BA may say, great, it's really good for us because we can really grow our business and make lots of money for BA, create lots of UK jobs, benefit for the economy. But the other foreign carriers may say, but hold on a minute, there's a really good market down there in Surrey. I think I'll stay in Gatwick, actually, because I can make more money serving that market from Gatwick than I can by chasing BA to the new hub. So I think some real subtleties and dilemmas there that need to be worked through. Where they go to it, and I'll come back to it in my last slide, is how you actually make this thing stack up as an affordable proposition. Just some examples here of the market mix on routes, just really to sort of give you a bit of background. Quite a lot of transfer passengers coming from European capitals, but as I say, that's BA stealing Air France traffic, Star Alliance traffic. They're selling it cheap to steal it because it's a competitive market. USA, if we look at the sort of hatch lines opposed to solid colours, different routes, different transfer characteristics. They're not all homogenous. A lot of variation across the different markets. And it just depends who's flying it, as I'll come on to. India, you can see there that the two routes, Hyderabad and Bangalore, got lots of hatch traffic on their transfer traffic because they're new routes. BA's flying them. BA's underpinning those new services. Good for the economy by lots and lots of transfer passengers, principally coming from the USA. Routes to Delhi, Mumbai are much less dependent on transfer traffic, and within that, BA is more dependent than Air India and Kingfisher. China, though, where I've broken it down by carrier, is interesting because you can see there that where it's BA flying it, masses of transfer passengers. Where it's not BA flying it, very few transfer passengers, because the Chinese airlines are not interested in hubbing in the UK. Even if there was capacity, they would be interested. They're either going to hub where their alliance partners are based, which in the case of most of the Chinese airlines is either Frankfurt or Paris, or they're going to hub at their own end of the route. They're going to hub in Beijing or Shanghai. So BA is the one who's interested in the hub, not the other carriers. And that's back to my message, that the other carriers may well find other ways of meeting demand because they have their own hubs that it's more financially beneficial for them to actually use. So we have to look at BA and the other airlines slightly differently. Affordability is important because even for BA, and I think Foster's have been telling me that they're already getting this message from Willie Walton and his colleagues, it's got to be at a price. Whatever we do by way of a new hub, it's got to be at a price that the airlines can afford to pay. And I think that's sometimes where some of government policy decisions have gone wrong in the past, is they've not actually sat back and thought about how this would be paid for. There may well be net benefits to the UK from doing some of this, but those benefits aren't necessarily captured through the fare box by the airlines. And if the airlines can't afford to pay the airport charges, they won't operate the services. And that was the big flaw in the Stansted second runway proposal a few years ago. The government hadn't thought that through. They said there's a massive economic benefit from doing this, but they'd forgotten that actually wasn't accruing to the airlines, who weren't prepared to pay the bill. I think one of the challenges here is Heathrow's charges are already amongst the most expensive in Europe. So there's a question there about how can the new hub be funded, and I'm going to go into a little bit more detail. this slide is a bit out of date, apologies, I've borrowed it from something else, but it's the last sort of systematic comparison of airport charges across Europe that I can lay my hands on. Heathrow is already up here as one of the more expensive airports. Although airport charges have risen at a number of European airports since this chart was produced about 3 years ago, Heathrow's charges have been going up at RPI plus 7.5%, higher than anywhere else because of the funding of Terminal 5 and prospective funding, arguably, for a third runway. So the regulatory settlement at the moment allows Heathrow's charges to rise to around €17 per passenger. In other words, right at the top of the heap. So Heathrow is already darned expensive. So there isn't a lot of headroom for a new airport in London to be funded through higher airport charges. It has to be looked at, I think, in the context of what airlines are willing to pay at Heathrow today as kind of a litmus test and a benchmark. A bit techie here, but assuming airports can, well, the new hub will continue to be a regulated airport under government regulatory rules, even though they're changing, there may be technical changes in the way airports are regulated in terms of jetting charges. But most of those different forms still end up with roughly the same calculated answer at the end of the day. If it continues to be based on what they call the RAB, the regulatory asset base, under a building blocks approach, you add up how much it costs to operate the airport and how much it costs to build it, and you deduct how much commercial revenue you can generate, and you end up with a gap. And then you divide that by the number of passengers, and that tells you what the airport's allowed to charge. Assuming, as I do, that there isn't much headroom to raise charges higher than Heathrow is currently charging, it means if you can get the new hub airport up to a throughput of about 100 million passengers per annum quickly, you can afford to spend about 10 to 15 billion. Not far short of Lord Foster's 20 billion. So I'm relieved it's 20, not 40 or 50, because the gap's narrowing. But there's still a funding gap. And I think that's, again, is one of my challenges, about what can you do to lever in other sources of income or funding contribution. And it may well be, so I was talking to Hugh Thomas about before we started, it may well be that it's going back to governments about, hold on a minute, there's massive benefit for the UK in this, how do you capture that into the new hub airport? So I'm not saying it's an insoluble problem, but I think there's a gap there or a question that still needs to be addressed. So I think that is the end of my presentation. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thanks for the invitation to speak today. Just run through quickly so we can keep to time as to what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to set something of the contextual framing for some of these decisions about the expansion of capacity and the growth of the aviation industry globally and then down at the UK level. This is work that has been prepared predominantly by Alice Bowes, Kevin Anderson and Ruth Wood at the Tyndall Centre. They're all researchers based up at Manchester University and funded on various grants from research councils and the Jewell Centre, which was a Northwest Regional Development Agency group. So I'll introduce the cumulative emissions accounting framework as a basis for analysing climate problems and then work through different aviation growth scenarios and implications. Just to say that the Tyndall Centre was previously 7 partner universities in the UK, but we've recently welcomed Fudan University from Shanghai, which is going to be focusing on the political and social dimensions of climate change research. And also to qualify it, we don't do climate modelling in a meteorological sense. We don't run the large computer models. We work predominantly on emissions accounting, energy systems analysis, social science around that. Okay, I usually have to apologise for introducing graphs, but I think some of my other speakers have given us a few visuals already. So I'll just talk you through this one. What we look at when we look at understanding a particular climate change issue is to look at carbon budgets over the long term. The reason for doing this is that carbon dioxide stays up in the atmosphere for over 100 years and contributes to warming throughout that period of time. Any new emissions going up continue to warm out into the future and get added onto the emissions that have already gone up. So in this graph, we've got through time along the bottom for the first half of this century and with annual emissions drawn out up the y-axis. Now, what we're interested in here, in terms of climate stability and meeting a particular climate objective, is the total quantity of emissions over the period of time. That's work done here by Miles Allen and colleagues in Oxford University, has associated this total quantity of emissions with the ultimate change in temperature of the global climate, more closely than a final atmospheric target or a particular quantity of emissions at any given point in time. So, in our analyses, we look at pathways that meet a particular climate objective, i.e. a particular quantity of emissions under this graph. We look at the emissions that have already been released and then where we could go in future. Now, if you're looking at different alternatives, if you constrain that total quantity of emissions over a period of time and you increase emissions in the short term, for instance, then that leads you to a couple of different conclusions. If you're going to keep the same climate impact, then these areas of emissions growth in the short term and reductions in the long term needs to be equal. And so that shifts your ultimate long-term targets, and these are things that receive most attention at the moment, makes them lower, and it pushes the trajectory of decarbonisation to be steeper, and this has implications for the technologies and the social practices that you would use to meet these objectives. Okay, so some recent work, just to set the kind of the global framing of what our total safe emissions budgets might be, looks at the current trends in non-Annex 1 countries, developing countries, poorer economies, majority world, however you want to phrase it. And so we've looked at a number of assumptions modelled out into the future. So if you take growth rate in emissions as around 3.5% per annum, averaged over the whole group of non-Annex 1 nations, and you take a peaking date of 2025, and so this is the point when emissions would be at a maximum, and that there would be no further growth in the developing economy's output from this date, and that's not so far in the future. And then you look at a 7% reduction from that period, which is twice the rate that Stern envisaged within his analysis. That produces this total trajectory of where we might see CO2 emissions globally for the 21st century for the developing nations. Now the question then is, from a safe budget, how much does that leave for us? How much does that leave for the rich developed nations? And what are the implications for that in our energy policy? Not a lot, in short conclusion. This budget gives us a 37% chance of avoiding a 2 degrees warming, which we would say is a reasonable chance. Not a good chance, but a reasonable chance. And if we allow that safe space for the poorer economies, then what we've got here is the fact that we would all have to have peaked already in the past, reduce at an essentially infinite rate down to total decarbonisation for the rest of the century. And so this is the background for how we might think about future planning. So just kind of broadening this a little bit, and you can read these in the details of the papers of Alice Bowes and Kevin Anderson. So if we take this link to be broadly correct between cumulative emissions and temperature rise, and we make these assumptions about peaking, about deforestation, about food emissions per capita halving from today's value. So this isn't about an intensification of diet, this is a reduction in the intensity of diet. And we assume that the climate is linear, there are no discontinuities, no tipping points that alter the climatic responses. And then we put in Stern, Committee on Climate Change, International Energy Agency, maximum feasible reduction rates of 3-4% in rich economies. Then the conclusions that you draw is that a 2 degree stabilisation appears to be virtually impossible, and that 4 degrees, potentially by 2070, looks likely and potentially on the way to 6 degrees. So these are quite stark and challenging conclusions drawn from what are the current drivers of climate policy. I mean, even the Committee on Climate Change, which has been advising on the UK's budgets, which are some of the most stringent in the world, is premised on a 63% chance of exceeding a 2 degrees target, which is, I don't think can be regarded as keeping to the commitments made in the Copenhagen Accord, which said that we would avoid 2 degrees on the basis of science and equity. So what does 2 degrees mean? If you look back to the IPCC's fourth assessment report in 2008, there's a fifth due next year, you've got quite substantial changes globally in terms of ecosystems and social consequences that result from changes in food productivity and coastal flooding and the like. In producing the fourth assessment report, the IPCC updated its reasons for concern. And on the left-hand side here, we have the reasons for concern in the third assessment in 2001, and on the right, subsequent to the fourth assessment in 2009. And what we can see is that 2 degrees, which was previously regarded as the boundary between acceptable and safe climate change, the indicators that would give us reason for concern have shifted downwards, so that 2 degrees now appears to be a boundary between dangerous and very dangerous of levels of climate change, rather than a kind of a guardrail, as it were, for working towards. So just in summary, kind of looking at the cumulative emissions analysis emphasises to us that final targets are unrelated to avoiding dangerous climate change. And we need to look at the pathways of how we get to those targets and the emissions that we put out in the process. And this kind of emphasises that delay is making the problem worse, and that we need to think outside from gradual reductions and marginal change and consider urgent and radical reductions if we are sincere in meeting our climate objectives. So then, to look at what this challenges the aviation industry to do is to look at particular characteristics of the aviation industry that present this a challenge. And so we have issues around the reliance on kerosene and conventional jet fuels, the long lifetime of aircraft technology, the lock-in between aircraft flying now and their economic return rates over many decades, the absence of technological step changes, so that you're always balancing marginal changes in efficiency with growth rates that at present seem to be outstripping those. The fact that growth has been higher than in many other sectors historically and is expected to return following the economic downturn, and that most of the population currently don't fly. So arguably, the impacts of aviation are visited upon a majority that doesn't experience the benefits, or conversely, the opportunities for growth are very high because there are many more potential customers. And finally, just to say that all of our analysis considers carbon dioxide emissions in its budgeting, and not the other additional radiative forces that the aviation industry contributes to. So some work done in 2010 by Alice Bowes looked at various industry and government scenarios for projected growth in emissions from the industry at a global level, and then compared them to a set of budgets that give reasonable chances of avoiding dangerous climate change, and found that at some point in the latter half of the middle of this century, the total global budget is exceeded in 5 of 18 comparisons by this single sector. If we scale that down to UK decarbonisation pathways, and we look at the same sorts of budgets allocated on a per capita basis for the UK, using 2 different budgets here with different probabilities and different assumptions. I think they have the same assumptions about deforestation, but different probabilities of meeting a target. Then what you can see is that government forecasts and the Committee on Climate Change targets all present us with the same kind of crossing point, where emissions from this sector meet the entirety of the budget. And so this, of course, kind of raises implications for tradability and exchange of emissions with different parts of the economy. And this shouldn't just be seen as something that raises problems and difficulties around the 2030s. For all of this period in the run-up, 2020 onwards, if we were serious about meeting these targets, the rest of the economy is meeting harder and harder and steeper decarbonisation in order to accommodate a persistent degree of emissions from the aviation sector. Aviation makes up an increasing part of carbon budgets and then places pressure on other sectors. Something that we were funded to do by the Northwest Regional Development Agency was to look at if it was possible to account for aviation at a regional level and associate emissions with the airports within the Northwest. And so begin to kind of account and attribute at a regional scale. So what we concluded was the most appropriate methodology was a hybrid one that looked at both producers and consumers in terms of attributing responsibility for emissions. Producers in terms of the airport and the airlines, who have control over the landing and takeoff cycle, and consumers in terms of residents and tourists who are flying in and out of the airport, and then also reflect some of the local economic benefits directly from hosting an airport and indirectly from providing services to residents, businesses and tourists. So like I say, so the landing and takeoff emissions were attributed to local emissions inventories, and then the cruise phase emissions were apportioned to the region from within which passengers start their journey, rather than emissions solely being apportioned at the national level. And what this shows is that if you looked at the Northwest aviation industry on its own, and then as a proportion of total UK emissions per capita, and then looked at a percentage of the total Northwest emissions, you see that by including the LTO cycle, you've got a more kind of reasonable assumption of the industry at a regional level. This changes the kind of the map of the distribution of how aviation would be attributed within different parts of the UK's population. As you see, presently London is a very dark, intense spot were you to account for the emissions associated with the airports around London and attribute them solely to that local population rather than dispersing them nationally. If you then move to this hybrid apportionment, London still has quite a kind of substantial per capita responsibility, but that other regions, such as for instance the Northwest, which hosts large regional airports in Manchester and Liverpool, and then also the Southwest, which has a great deal of passenger outbound and inbound passenger travel, but not through its own airports. This presents a different way of understanding the governance challenges of reducing emissions from aviation. So finally, just to conclude on how we would see the framing conditions for talking about new aviation capacity growth is to remember that lock-in and the very limited quantity of emissions space available in safe budgets pushes aviation to grow considerably as a proportion of total emissions. That emissions trading then becomes problematic in the medium term were you to have caps that reflected a 2 degrees target. As I said, that declining share for other industries would then have ramifications for other emissions intensive industries, and potentially also in terms of fuel poverty when they're passed on through the power sector. And that the priority, as we would see it, for investment in the aviation industry would be in accelerating R&D, looking at demand management and destination shifts, and emphasising policy around particular business sectors and travel sectors that are of most benefit to national strategic objectives, as opposed to having a free rein over growth with a predict and provide framework. I'll leave it there.
First reaction is really to congratulate the three speakers on contributing to the debate on the vital issue of London's I quote, hub airport. And I say that in the same spirit as the contribution that that we made last night by seeking to share some of the work that we'd been doing on a proposal for a hub airport. I think that I hesitate to draw the analogy, but I think there's a parallel with the state of pregnancy. You either are or you are not. I think a hub airport is either a hub airport or it's not a hub airport. And the idea of redressing Heathrow as a hub airport, I think, is long gone, or near gone. It's already gone in the sense that if you look at BA's policy in terms of Iberia and Madrid, if I look at those of us who, when we need to go to those emerging markets, which are not catered for by Heathrow, therefore Heathrow is not a hub, we have to go to places like Madrid. We go to Madrid to go to Latin America. So it is a fact of life. And the question is really whether we want to regain that or not. And that, I think that in a way, Dr. Broderick's point about the need of climate change not really lending itself to gradual solutions, but in need of urgent and radical solutions, I think is the perfect phrase for the need for a hub. With all respect to Chris Moore's excellent presentation, I think really the nature of the hub is that it's not a London hub, it's a UK, it's a United Kingdom hub. And he's absolutely right to highlight some of the competitive moves between rail and air. But I think that as we tried to demonstrate last night, really they should be working synergetically. And I think that it is only by a holistic approach to the issue of airport mobility, movement, and spreading prosperity across the current north-south divide that is truly achievable. And that is addressing not just the mobility associated with the airports, but the freight from the airports, the freight from the ports. We have incredible deep water ports. And 80%, as I was trying to demonstrate last night, of that freight is carried on roads. And the roads are being blocked. And if we can get a better balance of 50-50, then those are making significant inroads into carbon emissions. I think it's very, very difficult for those who have not experienced the quality of some high-speed rail systems and extraordinary connectivity in the emerging economies, where the contrast between the arrival at those destinations and the arrival at our destinations is stark, and not to our credit, but rather to our disgrace. And so I think it's very difficult to, if you envisage a truly high quality, very fast rail connection, and as we were demonstrating by the use of a London orbital, something that will bypass London in the interest of the wider economy, and also incidentally in terms of London's interest to reduce the congestion there, then a journey from Manchester to those destinations not served by Manchester. So this is not a threat to Manchester's excellent airport. But if you reduce the journey time currently, 3 hours and 15 minutes from Manchester to Heathrow, if you slash that to 1 hour and 50, then I think that the market and the customers will speak for themselves. And I think it's very, very difficult to predict. And if they have those incredible homes in Surrey, they may well find the prospect of an even more attractive village in Kent. And if Heathrow then becomes the great opportunity, which it is in real estate terms, even if we very modestly price it at its debt value of 12 billion, which is very, very conservative indeed, and you use the figures that Louise Congdon was talking about, then the thing's paid for itself almost already before you even think about it. So I think that in the spirit of adding to the debate, for me, I found them extremely interesting, and I think that they add more depth and dimension to the thing that government is obviously concerned with at the moment, and it's impossible not to talk about these projects without talking about growth, without talking about jobs, and ensuring the future competitiveness of the nation in terms of its GDP and not slipping down this scale. And as I said, I think that that really it's in a democratic society, it's just important to define our priorities, accept them, and live with them. So I think that we have choices, and I think these contributions and others to follow will make clear those choices. Thank you very much.
In the three presentations, I would just say there were issues again relating to the notions of capacity and whether we ought to be having a demand-led approach to how we provide airport capacity. And there were conflicting or different views from our three speakers on that. And also the nature of the market, whether the market is something that is demand in a general sense or whether it's very spatially specific and sector specific. So whether we ought to be looking at things more sensitively or not. Then there were issues relating to the way in which the aviation industry looks at the whole issue. That in the sense that they will be making a decision about moving there perhaps, and there seemed to be some complexity there as to whether this might just be for British Airways or it might be for other airlines as well, and what the implications of that was. We talked a little bit about as well, apart from Lord Foster, on the affordability issue. And then there was the question raised about the CO2 emissions and the issue about cumulative CO2 emissions and the challenge in one sense that on the one side we've got this huge increase in aviation and the emissions of CO2 at ground level and at high level and the need to totally decarbonize the economy if we were going to keep within the 2 degrees target that's being set. And related to that, there were various sorts of arguments about whether we follow this technologically led path about lock-in and what that leads to in terms of the future nature of business and the way in Britain operates. But I would come back to what Lord Foster said at the end, which was talking about the importance of growth, jobs and competition as well. I think we perhaps have underestimated a little bit the economics of the whole issue. We haven't talked a bit about that. So those to me were some of the issues that were being raised, and I hope that's a sufficient agenda to keep us engaged for the next sort of 40, 45 minutes. So the floor is now open for general questions, and you can direct them at anyone or everyone, and I'm sure they can handle them with the greatest of ease.
Just a quick question, I guess, on, I'm not quite sure why the government turned off the third runway at Heathrow. If you were to compare and contrast the Thamesway hub to the properly fully leveraging the existing airports, surely that's a better pitch along with high-speed rail than a new hub. From an aviation point of view, an environmental point of view?
I think from an aviation point of view, that's why the industry has to date, or until relatively recently, always consistently said the only real solution to the aviation industry has been thought of in terms of solving the problem at Heathrow, because Heathrow is in the right place to meet demand as it currently exists. I think the challenge we have, in a sense, is the one that Lord Foster posed, is if we're envisaging a different London, a London driven by the Thames Gateway, then the airport can play a valuable part in that. The problem, I think, is what's the chicken and what's the egg? There are lots of people around the world who believe, build the airport and it will fix my economy. And I have to say, I'm not one of those people and haven't been for 20 years or more. you have to understand where the market is, because unlike sewage systems, which are paid for as pieces of public infrastructure, aviation is given by airlines who are commercial beings who sell tickets to a myriad of individual passengers. It has to work for those commercial companies. You can't force them to do what goes against the market. And I think that's where we've still got this tension. But it's going to be interesting, because 20 years ago, nearly 20 years, 18 years ago, I was on a government working party that looked at railway capacity to serve the South East. And we looked at a proposal then called Marinair, which is Thames Estuary site. And that working party came at the back at the end of it and recommended, sorry, it has to be a third runway at Heathrow. 20 years on, it's like deja vu. We're now going to the same loop again.
Two's got interest. Yeah. I think they'll answer that first question, and then kind of, if that doesn't work, then maybe it's the replicate. Yeah. That's what we have to do.
But I think, you know, the reality is, politically, for all sorts of reasons to do with the noise impact on the local population, Heathrow always has been and will continue to be an extremely hard sell. Whether it's an impossible sell, as would appear to be the case at the moment, I'm not going to comment on that.
Yes, I would absolutely agree with Louise there that it's the politics, really. It is entirely unpalatable for the mayor to stand on a platform of expanding Heathrow, and with 4 to 5 year terms in government or in position as mayor, the easiest thing as a politician to do is to avoid the difficult decisions. And I think that's why we are perhaps going round in cycles, in circles, and certainly, as I say, from the mayor, he can't campaign on a platform of Runway 3. There are an awful lot of influential politicians at Westminster, now the Transport Secretary too, who would find that a very difficult thing to do. Whereas in pure cost-benefit terms, it could well give you the strongest answer, and certainly in the short to medium term, it in pure academic terms, it would be a strong solution too.
I'm going to assume that people have been looking at the recent case study of what happened in Ciudad Real. There's a similar proposal of having Javier Port that has completely not taken off.
Yeah. I mean, we did some work actually about 5 years ago, looking at the economic impact of Ciudad Real. But the problem we have is you can assess the economic impact of what an airport might do. And another quite good example is that's different, in a sense, but you might have heard Doncaster Finning, the airport, Robin Hood Airport. I was involved in a public inquiry into that. And the people in Doncaster had a view that if you build an airport there, it would fix the Doncaster economy. And that was never, ever going to happen. You had to fix the Doncaster economy and then work out what sort of airport you needed to serve that economy. And I think it's back, you know, this is exactly what we're about. If we've got a grand vision that says we're really now going to make Thames Gateway work, because we've been saying it for 20 years and we've never quite done it, it sort of stops, as I said to somebody, it stops by Canning Town DLR station, tube station, I reckon. Apart from the city airport and a little bit of NXL, there's not much east of Canning Town that's actually really worked in a gateway sense. And if we're really going to make the gateway work, and put all the infrastructure in and all the effort in to make the gateway work, then the logical follow-on from that is, let's build a Thames Estuarial Airport that fits part of that grand vision. But I think we really need to tackle that grand vision first and then decide what the airport solution is rather than the way around.
Can I just respond on the earlier comment about the third runway as well? Because I think what Chris said was very important. It's a short to medium term fix, so it's very attractive in that sense. If you just want to look as far as, you know, the end of the immediate story, it is incredibly attractive to have a third runway. It's not a full-length runway. It's not a competitor to the facilities that European hubs have. It's something that will bring in more short-haul traffic, more domestic traffic. But it doesn't solve the fundamental problem that Heathrow has of giving you long-distance connectivity. It doesn't solve the problem of A380s going to the new emerging markets and the top 25 cities 30 years from now. So it could take us 10 years to build a third runway at Heathrow. The number of people we would displace is quite substantial. It's not too dissimilar from the number of people who might be displaced by a new airport. The investment at Heathrow, the cost of doing construction activity on an operational airport, is horrific. the time impacts of doing that work are horrific. Just look at what's happening at Heathrow today. So, yes, it's immediately attractive if you just want to look at the short-term story. If you want to look long-term, it's not the answer. If you want to look long-term, where would you be better investing the money? Where would you be better investing the political capital and attracting finance? Where could you create a leap over our competitors to actually go out to the rest of the world and attract that finance? Because Heathrow won't attract that finance. We'll be locked into exactly the same problems of the existing regulated asset base assessment on landing takeoff, you know, landing charges at Heathrow. We'll have exactly the same problem, but we'll be making it worse. With a greenfield site with a fresh sheet of paper, then that investment actually allows you to look at how you reduce those charges, rather than, you know, trying to squeeze more into the bottle.
Somebody sort of spends 2 hours commuting to Heathrow twice a month. The on the high speed rail link from Oxford, the new hub would be superb for me. So from that angle, thank you.
Yeah, assuming the new airport goes ahead, for instance, is the question I want to ask. My question to the panel is, to what extent do you feel that it would be a major driver for the regeneration and economic development of northern regions of England and the wider United Kingdom in the context of Lord De Foster's big thing about connectivity?
I think I might have a different view from some other members of the panel. I'm a northerner. I spent 20 years working at Manchester Airport. And if you look at things as a northerner, and you look at someone who believes that actually there is some relevance in direct air service connectivity, and you talk about 1 hour 50 to the new hub, I'm sorry, Manchester, I don't think it's going to benefit a huge amount. Because at the moment, there are other ways of travelling globally from certainly the area in close proximity to Manchester Airport. There are other ways of travelling globally. And a 1 hour 50 train journey to a hub airport, probably a high cost rail journey, because it's high speed rail is not cheap, will result in a total journey cost far greater than the current or future ticket price being sold by the Arab hub carriers in the Gulf. And the reality is, the market will do what it's been doing for the last few years, which is bypassing Heathrow and using those Middle East well-located hubs to travel to China, India, subcontinent and the Far East. Because the total journey price, the total journey time, will be far better for the consumer. And that I think is the reality from the north, which is not quite the view I think that other members of the panel would be sharing.
Well, I'm like you, I'm a northerner, but I have a slightly different view in terms of connectivity. Looking at the regeneration of cities in the north, connectivity to London now is a big issue amongst key players. I'll give an example of that. If you take three cities across the M62 corridor, Hull, Manchester and Liverpool, Manchester will be regarded as the key economic driver for a number of reasons. But in train journeys to London, that has 28 direct services a day. Hull has none and Liverpool has 8. Now, you might have different views on whether the hub should go ahead, but I tell you, speaking to key people within the region, the ease of access to London, and for that matter, by default, if the hub was built, is a crucial significance.
Connectivity in London is extremely important. I'm not denying that. That is actually very important. But in terms of global connectivity, the hub may not help the north that much. Whether or not the hub located where it's proposed is the best solution providing the ease of access to London. Because again, you're looking at relative journey times, and if you do relative journey time calculations, you have to, we've done quite a lot, for example, from Carlisle, looking at Carlisle to London by air and by rail. And superficially, you say an air journey is going to be much, much better. But actually, when you look at door-to-door journey times to where people are trying to get to, more often than not, even with a relatively low frequency service train, even now, we're now, it may not be Hull because no direct service exists currently. But for most of the places served, for example, by the East Coast or the West Coast Main Line, the train will probably win as long as the fare level is competitive.
Oh yeah, and my issue isn't air services to the new hub. My issue is high-speed rail link to the hub to access the globalised economy. I mean, we're a relatively small country, so you know, we should be able to move about fairly quickly as folks. And that's the issue for me, the speed you can get to the hub.
Well, only to the extent that it drives increase in emissions and that there is an increase in aggregate quantity of travel rather than just a kind of a reorganisation of existing patterns of movement. I mean, that would be my concern about new hub capacity, is that it increases total quantities of movement rather than solving a number of kind of particular problems that have been identified with existing infrastructure. Were it a replacement for airport capacity, then that's one thing, but if it is an addition to capacity and hence to the possibility, I mean, like Chris was saying, that Heathrow's current capacity constraints act to restrain growth of aviation emissions, then relieving that would seem to be a backward step, and especially one that would attract large quantities of public or private capital. I think we could look at different places to invest strategically that would have a much more beneficial effect on global welfare and well-being through avoidance of the worst consequences of climate change.
Yes. This was actually going to be geared towards Lord Foster, but he's not here, so I'm not sure who would be the best to answer this on the panel. My question is regarding the cost of the airport. It was mentioned that it's going to be 100% privately funded, but I was wondering where that private funding would come from and what would happen in the event of a funding shortfall. I was at a seminar on Thursday where one of the discussions was the Olympic Village, and the Olympic Village was supposed to be this wonderful public-private partnership where there was a lot of money coming in from the private sector, but they say when they pulled back the curtain, only 2% of the funding actually came from the private sector, the rest of it came from the public sector. So in a situation like this, if there is a shortfall, or a large shortfall, would a lot of that money come from the public sector? How would that be worked out?
Yeah, thanks. The figures that we've worked out are $20 billion for the airport itself. Now, the airport is the aviation aspect, and Louise is quite right. A lot of the income, the benefits generated by an airport isn't actually within the landside airside enclosure that the passenger sees. It's the secondary activities that benefit. On the airport itself, certainly from the conversations we've had with people in finance, in global finance, the attractiveness of a global aviation hub in Europe, the opportunity to invest on a clean sheet of paper, that's something that there's an awful lot of interest in. There's an awful lot of interest in that for a number of reasons, not least because it's relatively cheap. $20 billion to build an airport of that size compared to what it costs to expand and invest in other airports in Europe is actually very good value for money. Creating it where we're creating it, where there are very few people to live, living, and where it's relatively easy to form the land, that's good value for money. Can you capture the other elements? Can you capture particularly some of the cargo elements? And I'll just pick up on the previous question, how we believe it aids the northern cities. It's not just about passenger connectivity, it's about trade. And we've lost our notion of ourselves as traders. You know, people talk an awful lot about rebalancing the economy, moving us away from financial services back towards making things again, back to the things that the northern cities would actually be very good at, where the infrastructure is in place. But what we don't have is an ability to move goods around and to access those global markets in the way that we did historically. We don't use our ports the way we did. So what rail does and what the orbital does is give you connectivity into the manufacturing heartlands. It gives you connectivity to the northeast, the northwest, the Midlands, to the Peel Holdings, Atlantic Gateway, Manchester Shipping Canal Belt. It gives you that connection into a very vital part of global trade, which is aviation, belly freight. Chris mentioned $100 billion being transferred in terms of goods by air. At the moment, an awful lot of that's imports. Wouldn't it be fantastic to have an incredibly efficient transport sector that allowed us to export things? It made us attractive to the rest of the world to come in and invest, to actually make things, because you could get them out of the country easily. So could you capture some of that benefit? Could you capture some of that trading benefit by some of the secondary, the airport city? And I know airport city is something that a lot of people talk about it, and you know, there's a lot of excitement about what it might mean. But down there on the Isle of Grain is the opportunity really to create a very, very focused, almost a ring-fenced enterprise zone that's connected to the airport, where those true benefits can be captured and brought in to help pay for the totality. So, answering your question, we believe there's a phenomenal appetite there for something like this, because nobody else can offer it. And it should be more than just what people think about maybe as a passenger facility. It's got to bring in the whole of the benefits of aviation.
Can I just ask you a follow-up question with Rachel, as you said at the beginning? Can you explain this point about it's 12 billion of debt at Heathrow, how that debt then is used to contribute to the cost of this hub? Because as I see it, BAA for OVL are going to want to realise the value of the land released at Heathrow to pay down their debt, but I don't see how that 12 billion transfers across.
The 12 billion is really the RAM on board that company exists Heathrow.
Right, okay.
The outstanding debt at Heathrow, if you imagine a 10-year process, if you sweat your asset, you can be paying down the debt. So if you complete the current investment program and you then sweat that asset, you're paying down the debt. Mm. If you maintain the RAB envelope, then you'll be going to release investment.
Yeah.
And then that's all paid off effectively in the conservative figure by the underlying RAM value.
I still don't quite say 12 billion transfers across, but I can see the 12 billion RAB envelope working, but I don't say 12 billion
actual. It's just an indicative figure, it's not a direct transfer.
Yes, what I would say in response to that is that airports are inherently profitable, 10 to 20% profit margins, and while it might be difficult to capture the benefits fully and difficult to account for them and have them tangible, if it were the country, the public sector that had to take a hit, then we would have to say, are those countries, all those other countries around the world that are building brand new airports, are they getting it wrong? And I think that's where we would have to think more about it. Might not be easy to make the case formally, but we have to think about the wider benefits, the wider impact it's having, and why would we want to plough our own furrow and not follow what the rest of the world are doing?
Respond to? He ended up with a question.
I think that the investment in infrastructure is extraordinarily important. Rail, airports is always important. I wonder if the economic benefits from it are worthwhile if it does come from the public sector, where there is so much demand for affordable housing that needs to work on, and there's issues with education. We have been the same problems in the U.S. and it's always this matter of trade-offs. And you dodge this issue of trade-offs when you make the whole thing 100% privately funded. But in reality, that doesn't usually always happen. It usually always ends up coming from the purse of the public sector. So I guess that was my question. In the contingency of that shortfall of funding, how do you make up for that? You know, where does that come from? And have you addressed the repercussions of that? And I guess I agree with what you're saying, that the investment is important, but you always worry about these massive projects and where the funding will actually come from.
I think it goes back to what Lord Foster said last night, doesn't it? Which is in terms of that funding gap, which I raised as a key issue, but I think I'm raising it as a key issue, because I suspect the only way to actually make this work is for us to grasp the nettle in the public sector to put in a fair slug of money. And I've been coming to that view over the last sort of 5 or 10 years, that actually the idea that you could privately fund airports and and deliver probably wasn't right, and we probably had to look to the fact that most of the rest of the world airports are at least in part funded, or major airports are at least in part funded by public purse. We're probably reaching the point of some strategic choices about what sort of economy and society we want to have. And it goes to the climate change issue very much, in that if we want to have growth, in a sense, we've got to have the things that will drive and support that growth, and we have to pay for them. And infrastructure and global connectivity, however we solve the dilemma, is part of that. If we've got to constrain that connectivity, then we probably can't have that economic growth. We can meet the climate change dilemma, but I think society's got to make a choice here about what does it want for the future? Does it want a low growth economy and meeting all our climate change targets and not investing in infrastructure? Or do we want to have a growth economy and find other ways of dealing with the climate change issue?
That always sounds like other ways of dealing with the climate change issue. That's quite an ominous threat. As came to mind is, I mean, I think that green growth is being oversold in developed economies, in already rich economies. I think that's something that's increasingly coming out of the climate change community, is that the opportunities for decarbonisation at rates greater than economic growth seem to be very challenging indeed. And so where public investment is concerned, investing it in high emissions intensity sectors of the economy seems to raise fundamental questions. Will Foster said, what do we want out of life? Where do we want to direct our economy and our society to go? And it does seem to be that the drivers are directing away from climatic stability.
Two quick answers. We don't do major investment in this country. It's impossible. The private sector can't take on a large scale project. There are no examples of them achieving this. Absolutely wrong. On the other side of the Thames, Dubai Port World Investing in London Gateway are doing just that. It may only be 25% of the value of what we're proposing, but in ports, we're doing it. Hutchinson Whampoa and Felixstowe just increased capacity there by 20%. Purely private investment. The investment going into Liverpool, the same into Southampton. So in terms of global trade, people are investing. That is happening. It's off the radar. Nobody pays any attention to it. It's extraordinary they ignore it, but it's happening. In terms of climate change and what we can do nationally to create a step change, one of the things we think that the spine does, the idea of using the rail corridor for transmission, is it actually introduces a new paradigm in terms of energy generation, transmission and distribution. Because yes, it can deal with high voltage DC transmission to conurbation rings using latest gas insulated transmission technologies, which reduce loss, so that's a benefit. But alongside that, you can actually produce a far smarter AC transmission and distribution network. What that does is it creates a marketplace for smart energy that we don't have in this country. What it immediately unlocks is the ability for the rural environments to start looking at distributed renewable generation in a smart way, because all of a sudden they've got a marketplace. They've got a marketplace to sell into. That's what they don't have at the moment. That's what's really stymieing so much of that activity. Could that corridor actually unlock a whole ecology of new energy production? Because as soon as you're smart in generating energy, you're smart in consuming it as well. So you begin to get a virtuous cycle developing. I think that's what the corridor could unlock in that regard. Is she gone?
Yeah, she had to leave.
I thought she was dying to ask a question.
He was.
Other questions?
Thank you very much. Coming from the perspective of ecological economics, and more specifically multi-criteria approaches to justifying various decisions in the project, I'm just wondering whether there is scope of to consider not just to build or not to build, so to speak, but maybe several different strategies or several different scenarios, something in Birmingham or something where it's suggested at the moment, and look at many criteria, because we immediately are confronted with that issue of the scale of creating additional employment by all of these options, the effects on biodiversity and ecosystems, the potential to reduce emissions, and you could continue with that. But this is a framework which has been proven to be very powerful and extremely useful. And what they were thinking.
So is that looking at a diffuse strategy of actually locating capacity in several different places rather than in one place?
Oh, rather considering several scenarios of things simultaneously. You know, not just one project and whether we go for it or not, but actually to build the strategy from various elements and see what each of them would add, or something like this.
I think in practice that's the process that we went through in the Government Working Party 20 years ago. It's the process the government went through in coming up with the previous government coming up with its white paper in 2003. And it's the process one assumes the current government are going through with a view to bringing out an aviation policy in 2013. What they haven't done yet is tell us what their appraisal framework is going to look like. But in 2003, they looked at a number of different option combination solutions, and they had a very clearly defined appraisal framework that took environmental as well as economic issues into account. I'm assuming that they are going to adopt, if they're going to do anything site-specific, that they're going to adopt something similar. Although I have to say that my discussions with the department have said they're not actually going to come out with a policy which is site-specific. They're going to come out with a set of criteria against which people can make their propositions to be tested. So the outcome in 2013 may not be we're going to build here or we're going to build there. It may well be your appraisal framework that you're advocating.
I think the right thing to do is to think about how aviation fits in and how an airport can be a real stimulus for a whole region and maybe beyond. But what we can't do is think about dispersing the UK's demand across several regional airports. We have to bear in mind that it is essential the UK has a world-leading hub, and it's in that sense that the solution has to be an enormous single place idea wherever it goes. I think if we look at Birmingham Airport at the moment, plenty of spare capacity, very few long-haul flights. It's reasonably well located, it's reasonably accessible from lots of areas of the home county and people that are using Heathrow. But quite simply, because it's not a hub and it's not got all the demand being consolidated there, the mixture of demand, the cross-sector demand, it can't operate those marginal flights beyond the sort of small number of the most lucrative long-haul destinations. And I think that's why the government's policy needs to, at its core, have a solution for a hub.
Can I also say that I think people often raise this in terms of cost, and it's a fallacy. I mean, Gatwick is nearing capacity in any case, so Gatwick, in order to do what you're suggesting, requires a second runway. All of the political problems, the time delays of that, the massive investment in providing that. Luton, for example, would need to be extended. Massive landfill to extend Luton's runway. More runways at Stansted. The idea of connecting Gatwick to Heathrow, building a high-speed rail. Well, the high-speed rail is 80% of the length of the orbital we're proposing. The costs, they're not discussed, but there are real costs associated with growing the capacity of all of those airports. Isn't it better to pick all of that up and do it once in one location that's ideally suited for it?
Thanks for the very interesting presentation. Today we've talked a lot about the urgency of rebuilding the UK and London as a hub. But to take this debate a little further beyond the airport, I wonder how much of the current fear that London is losing its prominence is because of the lack of a more liberal aviation policy by the government in terms of freedom rights given to airlines. So I can think of a number of airlines that in Asia that would actually like to fly to London, or fly to New York via London, such as Singapore, Cathay Pacific, but they're not able to do that. So is that also like why? I think Louise mentioned earlier about how Iberia is, or rather BA is, flying through
Madrid. It's part of the reason, you're absolutely right. Some of those routes and services were missing, and some of the things that people say about lack of routes to China are actually a product of not just the UK government's air service regime, and I know there's a Singapore situation well, but also the Chinese government's air services regime. Some of those Chinese carriers were actually told by their government which airports in Europe they could fly to. And so some were not allowed by their government to fly to London, even if they wanted to. As a result, they've then joined Star Alliance or SkyTeam Alliance. And as a result, their primary focus now is in working with their alliance partners in either Frankfurt or Paris or Amsterdam. So the government's, it's not quite just a matter of airport capacity. There's an aviation political dimension as well. I think the presumption has to be over time that those liberalisation, that those barriers to liberalisation will gradually get broken down, as they have done in Europe. The obvious, you know, ASEAN Open Skies is happening. The ASEAN bloc will then eventually negotiate with the European bloc in the same way the European bloc has negotiated with the US. So I think a long-term presumption has to be those barriers are taken away. But at the moment, some of what you see in the pattern of air services is not a product simply of airport capacity shortage, but a product of government diktat. You're right.
And do you see these airline alliances changing over time? Is there going to be some sort of winnowing out, or is this something that we're going to be living with, say, for the next 20 or 30 years?
Aviation changes. I've been in business a long time, and it's always very dangerous to say, oh, it's going to be like that for the next 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years. But in discussing things at the moment, nobody in the industry foresees much change in the alliance structure. We had more alliances. They've consolidated down to three substantial alliances. I think the only open question is whether or not the Middle East bloc coalesce in some way to form a new cohesive alliance, a bit like Lufthansa anchor Star, BA anchors One World, KLM Air France anchors SkyTeam. Although Emirates and Etihad and Qatar and Gulf Air are all saying we're not interested in alliances, I think an awful lot of people around are saying, but that may not last for much longer. And particularly if Etihad and Emirates were to merge, as has sometimes been suggested, because of the political closeness of Dubai and Abu Dhabi, it's possible that they may decide to try and do their own alliance building. But the truth is, there's not that many significant global carriers at the moment that aren't in some way, shape, or form aligned. So there's not many players to go at. And the ones that are still in play are probably the least attractive ones.
But an alliance needs a strong home hub, and we can't take for granted that the UK will always have British Airways at the heart of the One World Alliance. We could see the airline industry going the way of the car industry, that's less aligned with nations, and in that sense there's a risk that the UK loses a strong dominant carrier.
Yeah, that's right. The hub is really about BA, that's what I tried to say in some of my slides. The hub is about BA, and BA's role in the UK, more than it is about what the other airlines may choose to do. Or BA and One World.
Still a question, coming back to the financing issue. BAA, I suppose, has come under quite a lot of scrutiny for its financing, ownership and governance, particularly since the acquisition by the Spanish Ferrovial Consortium. Just wanted to get your thoughts on that, and what lessons perhaps could be learned from that experience for airports in the future and for the hub airport that's proposed.
I think it's a difficult one. The mistake I think Ferrovial made was to believe that the monopoly they had over the three main London airports wasn't going to be threatened. And the fact that, you know, so I think that's the mistake they made, that they bought something thinking they were going to be able to keep all their airports, and then found actually they were under threat. Whether they overpaid or not is another interesting question, because I think that may come back to a political psyche in different countries, in that I think because elsewhere there's more of a tendency for the government to fund things, we're back to the conversation we had earlier, than in the UK, it was tempting for foreign investors to buy something that was due for expansion, i.e. the third runway at Heathrow and the second runway at Stansted, on the basis that they could leverage, they could pay quite a bit now, but they'd leverage the government to help them fund it, because it was government policy, wasn't it? The government will therefore put some money in. To date, at airports in the UK over the last 20 years, that hasn't been the case. So they caught a cold because they overpaid. They overpaid because they thought the government would give them financial help to build new runways, which then got cancelled anyway, and they didn't anticipate the backlash against the monopoly. So I think as long as we're talking about a freestanding investment in new infrastructure, i.e. it's not BAA trying to, you know, BAA trying to run two big airports anymore, if it's BAA, Provial, ABI, whatever they're called, moving their investment across to a new hub, fine. But we don't want to recreate a monopoly situation across three airports. And as long as we've exposed up front this tension we've been talking about between how much of it's funded purely by the private sector and how much of it does need to lever in some public sector support in part to make the whole thing work. I think as long as that's up front and clear, so everyone knows what they're investing in, we should be okay.
I think it's very much about political leadership and will. The question is very well known, and anybody investing, that's going to be in the forefront of their mind. What are the political risks? Because they're purely political risks, they're not economic risks at that level. So structuring something where there is political support, cross-party support, is absolutely critical. You can't have on the change of government and election a complete breakfast and policy. So that has to be understood. And the sums of money and the commitments being made, probably intergovernmental level, to make this happen, that's a pretty good guarantee that something will have to be sorted out.
We shouldn't be afraid of putting the idea to the market. And in terms of the political point, I think it was Maria Eagle who recently suggested that aviation policy should perhaps be the subject of an independent committee, something a little bit removed from the political cycles because of its timescales and the challenges associated.
Just as that, I mean, in a sense, that's what the emissions trading scheme has done. It's acted as some kind of anaesthetic to the problem in the short term by saying that we will not allow an emissions budget to constrain aviation growth in the UK in the near term. We will allow buyout of cheap permits from other sectors. And that's served to kind of alleviate and remove from what is quite clearly a political decision from a political realm and put it into a financial realm. And I think personally that that's quite a retrograde step.
But it's actually given more certainty to the market in terms of what it has the confidence to invest large amounts of money into capital capacity.
Since we're looking at 2030, 2050 timelines, do any of the panelists have thoughts on what happens if there is a creative destruction technology that comes into play in the aviation industry? Because so much of the infrastructure that's being planned or talked about assumes a continuation of the duopoly in airline manufacturing, the same lengths of flights possible, the same time taken possible. But as you say, we've got to go straight down in carbon emission reduction. And so if there are major changes in technology, Elon Musk of Tesla in the Silicon Valley, or Richard Branson succeeded making space travel, for example, 2050 feasible, will the new airport complement that, or will the hub no longer be needed?
The only technologies, as far as I'm aware, that have been raised in workshops that we've held, and I have to admit of not being participants in those, but I've heard people talking about airships as an air freight technology,
with a low emissions per ton of freight moved intensity, which would be, you know, a substantial positive step forward. But as we're seeing kind of in global shipping terms, Maersk is advancing rapidly with the capacity for its ships in a kind of a European and then Asian connectivity line. And so I think, you know, in terms of rapid changes, you know, responses to climate challenges that deliver quick reductions, I mean, shifts in where possible freight from air to sea present substantial, you know, per ton moved intensity gains. And so the connectivity on the coastline clearly kind of offers intermodal opportunities.
I think we need to encourage radical thinking. I think it would be a great thing for the industry if it was to make a breakthrough, for example, with silent aircraft. We don't know whether there is that step change that could occur. If it did, it would certainly be much for the better for long distance travel and for the connectivity benefits it provides. I suppose at the moment we have to plan to a central pace and straightforward assumptions and, as you say, a linear progression, but who knows?
So my hunch is we've got to plan for the change to be incremental, but design and develop whatever we do with the flexibility to deal with that radical change that none of us can quite foresee, because there have been so many radical changes. I remember when, you know, there was one cash machine in any town you went to and you had to find that machine, you know, and now cash machines are everywhere and we don't use cash because we just use our cards anyway. And I think if you said to people 20, 30 years ago, were we going to move to a cashless society and what would the impact of that be, we probably would have been sitting here not quite knowing the answer. And I think we're probably in that situation now. Is the only thing you can do in the aviation industry is know that whatever you plan for more than about 5 to 10 years ahead, the world's probably going to be different by the time you get there.
I mean, just on a cautionary note for silver bullets and kind of radical technologies, that's often been talked about in terms of climate change mitigation, and that we always need the next generation of technologies. The idea that, you know, fusion power is only 50 years away. I mean, it was 50 years away when I was a nipper watching Tomorrow's World, and it's, you know, 50 years away now. And I think Professor Anderson, my boss, says it was 50 years away when he was kind of working on the oil rigs in the North Sea as an apprentice. And as I've kind of framed it, if we're thinking in terms of cumulative emissions, those kind of ideal futures that may realise total decarbonisation are not the important policy focus. The policy focus is how you get there and the emissions that you put out in the time you take to get there. And that every delay is just contributing and adding to the problem, just building it up, building up the stock of pollutants in the atmosphere year on year on year. And so I think it's... it's dangerous enough talking in solely infrastructure terms in terms of climate mitigation, because lots of large infrastructure projects that would be possible that would reduce emissions only come to fruition in the order of 10 to 20 to 30 years in the future. Yet, the kind of the imperatives for decarbonisation are much closer to home, and we need to start looking at different demand management and different transitions in economic and social practices, working practices, leisure practices, to deliver the scale of change in the timescale that is relevant to avoiding dangerous climate change. I mean, it's a question that keeps being raised with a new fleet of nuclear power stations in the UK. I mean, arguably they're part of a medium to long-term decarbonised grid system, but that they shouldn't be the focus for our energy policy because they don't deliver the near-term reductions.
I think that the social practices is very important, that people actually understand the implication of the choices they make. Where we do see changes in aviation is the undoubted interest in biofuels and the investment going into biofuels, both by the aviation companies, but probably more quietly by the militaries around the world. The American Great Green Fleet Initiative to get 30% of liquid fuels from biofuel sources is certainly one of the big drivers. and you've got any number of flights almost on a monthly basis now. New records are being set for biofuel flights. So maybe that is coming along and we're not actually recognising. And maybe a bit of social push and policy push is helpful in that regard. Because certainly the feedback you read is that some of the biofuels are more efficient in terms of performance, but also not only are they reducing carbon through the way they're manufactured, but they're reducing nitrous oxide sulfides in the emission stream. So.
Just on the biofuels note, I mean, the supply chain matters a great deal there into lots of the kind of potential benefits. I mean, it's well recognised the competition for land arguments around biofuels, and as far as I'm aware, the American military is emphasising second and third generation biofuels from aquatic sources, algal-based biofuels, because lots of those soy-based biofuels and the like that are dominating consumption at present have very long payback times if you look at the conversion of land at source in order to grow the biofuels in the first place. You're talking many decades before you see the putative gains in emissions reduction, because you know, if you have clear-felled forests or if you have transferred grasslands in order to grow biofuels in the first place, you only see those quick emissions wins when you substitute existing croplands and plant the present generation.
I completely agree that it's the second generation algals which are going to deliver the big benefits, because they're sequestering carbon at the same time in production. So you want
they're producing from the
yeah.
Yes.
Okay, I think we're sort of on time or out of time. Hugh, you have a task if you wish to accept it, just to sort of try and bring together some of the sort of salient points that you've seen as well, how this might lead back into the work that Professor Collins is doing with respect to this large scale project.
Well, I think it's very interesting the points you set out at the beginning of how the discussion has gone. Suddenly, the points that have been made, you started off with hope. It's what the government has posed in the aviation review in terms of airspace requirements in the southeast. What do we all think? And the consultation responses that have gone in have very much focused on ideas of distributed capacity or focused capacity. We very firmly believe that focused capacity is the way to go, because that gives you the biggest wins in terms of connectivity, and it also gives you a facility which no matter what happens in the future, you've got the facility. It was the most efficient, it was the most cost effective way of building something, but you've actually got the capacity there, so you can cope with the changes in the market because you've got that level of capacity. So hub, I think, is very interesting. And, in the Chancellor's review statement, autumn statement today, he's made that point that all options are open for looking at that global capacity, and it's that global capacity which we believe is so important for us nationally in a rapidly globalising market with the new entrants. That's the level of connectivity we need to maintain. We need to be able to interact with those new emerging nations, that global economy. So we see that as critical. And it's also hub not only in terms of aviation, but the investment you make around the aviation hub, how you use that to greatest effect for the whole of the nation, how you connect into the north. Because the facilities you create to connect into that airport can serve so many other purposes, particularly the rail. That if we eventually get new baseload nuclear or large-scale offshore winds, then the most cost-effective in terms of carbon emissions way of transporting things is undoubtedly going to be through use of electrical energy, and that's going to be rail. So what can we get bigger picture from that investment? How can we really stitch it together nationally? That's a debate we really should be having. We should be thinking about how this affects us as a nation. And it was a very interesting point when we were working on the project where someone relayed back to us the Dutch conversation. Are we a very densely populated country, or are we a very lightly populated city? And increasingly, we're becoming a lightly populated city. And if we get the connectivity in place, then we're connecting that economic activity together, then we get potentially major wins. What's the nature of the market, and how will the airlines react? I think that's a very important question. And there is such a rapidity of change, just the orders that are being placed in the Middle East for new aircraft, the new routes that they're going to open up, and the sheer amounts of belly freights that they're going to carry is going to radically transform, and we don't know how that new capacity will be deployed. What we think is that we need to have the ability to connect into that capacity, and that's all about capacity. We need the capacity to benefit from those structural changes in aviation. So we need to be engaging with the airlines, actually showing how they can fit in, and engaging with the investment community to see how we create something which is attractive to them. And then the wider economics, how do we capture that? And how do we think, again nationally, about the investment we've made in Thames Corridor? There's £9 billion of taxpayers' money over the last couple of decades gone into the Thames Corridor. What's it actually got us? Not an awful lot. It's got us the potential to do something, but there have never been the jobs. There's never been the employment there to actually really kickstart it. Well, if we thought about aviation and trade, and we thought about how it was placed and how it was tied in with the investment we've already made, then you really kickstart, you really begin to open up the opportunities there. And let's not forget the fact that we're a growing population, we're a growing nation. We're seeing 20% population increase over the next 20 years. That's a massive driver in our economy. It's massive on the demand side. Where are people going to live? How are we going to provide the houses for them? And in the southeast, there are pockets which are attracting 27% population increase over the next 20 years. Well, over 40 years, the last 40 years, we've grown somewhere around 15%. So we're going to grow more than a third again in 20 years. How are we going to accommodate that? We need some big ideas. We need to recognise the pressures on us, and we need some big ideas. And then how do you tie that into the opportunities for energy savings and really meeting an efficient energy production usage capacity? How do you deal with transport so that you're limiting, reducing your carbon emissions? How do you tackle that really traumatic challenge you've got? It's only by thinking holistically. And we think that an idea like the spine, if you can get your head around the spine, that you can think about doing something nationally, then there's a massive win there. Because that starts to trigger, you know, the ability to think about a whole host of things nationally. So we think that, you know, if we could rediscover that Victorian ability to think on a large scale, then a lot of the problems that we face might be an awful lot easier to tackle.
I think that is a very good way in which to end the proceedings. Can I thank our three speakers and also our four panellists and Hugh for so ably summing up on this, and also thank you guys for asking some very searching questions, which I think you've got quite a variety of answers to, so that there was no one sort of response.
Yes, I've been dispatched on election duties. I wonder whether we could just put it to the public vote about whether a Thames Estuary Airport is a good idea or a bad one.
Do you want to ask bad idea first?
Can we have it with a high speed rail as well, though, and have connectivity? Please.
Is this a good idea?
Good idea. What about the undecided?
I'm waiting for my questions to be answered.
Before we go, can I also say that to thank Humanitas, who were really the organisers of this, and over the 2 days I think we've had a really great lecture from Norman Foster, and I think we've had a good symposium this afternoon, and this has been facilitated by the Humanitas and the visiting professorship in architecture that's held by Rob Foster. this will end this year's event, but book it now in your diaries for next year. It's the same Monday and Tuesday in November. The talk will be different, the discussion will be different, and if you want to be here in the audience, great. If you don't, the audience will also be different. Thank you for participating.